Occupy Faith. This is a humble space and gathering today, but it's perhaps appropriate for what it is that we're actually doing here in Zuccotti Park on this beautiful morning. Last November 15th, following the eviction of the Occupy movement from Liberty Square, members of that movement asked Trinity Wall Street Episcopal Church, which had so far expressed their support of the movement, to provide this peaceful people's assembly with a sanctuary, specifically in the form of an empty lot on 6th Avenue and Canal Street. Trinity denied this request and authorized the arrests of those seeking to build a new Liberty Square at Duarte Park. Then again, a month later, on December 17th, Occupy protesters, their allies, various members of New York City clergy, including the retired Episcopal Bishop George Packer, protested Trinity's stance, arguing that as the third largest landowner in Manhattan, Trinity Wall Street was in a unique position to help the movement they claimed to support, to act like a church instead of a real estate company. But again, Trinity refused, and again there were arrests. Now, today, many of these activists and clergy, some of whom you see behind you, are getting ready for trial next week, some of whom will face up to 90 days in jail. So once again, we are here to ask Trinity Church to prayerfully search their hearts and drop the charges against our brothers and sisters, none of whom are criminals, none of whom are vandals, but in fact, people, our brothers and sisters, who put their bodies on the line for some of the very same values that Trinity Wall Street claims to represent and has represented so well in this city. Amen. So starting today and going until Sunday evening, we, some of the members of clergy and the Occupy movement gathered here and around the city, are asking for a time, calling for a time of prayerful and solemn witness, not only for those who face unjust persecution from an allied institution, but for the soul and conscience of one of this city's great communities of faith. We are asking for them to do what they have so often done in the past, simply to do the right thing. But we start this time today, we kick it off with three very remarkable testimonies. So instead of me talking anymore, you know what's going on, you know why we're here. I would like us to start off, it's my real privilege to welcome here the renowned activist, poet, priest, and one of my personal heroes, and maybe the reason I went to seminary in the first place, Father Dan Berrigan.
Very moving to me, very appropriate. And I tried to finish the question in these last weeks. What is real estate? What is real about real estate?
Let me repeat some of this for the larger crowd too, as you speak. Over the last week he's been asking himself, what is real estate?
What is real about real estate?
What is real about real estate?
What is unreal about real estate?
What is unreal about real estate?
Can we just draw some of these questions and clarify our witnessing of prayer?
Can we solve some of these questions and clarify our witness and what's placed upon us in this way?
Real estate is the real when it is in service to the common good.
Real estate is real when it is servant of a real common cause.
Amen. And when the people are being served by the real estate, it becomes real.
And that's when people who are serving real estate become real once more.
We are witnessing, in the case of Trinity, the unreality of real estate for the Washington.
We are witnessing with Trinity Wall Street, the unreality of real estate, which is now out of our control.
Which is to say, the real estate has become unreal by playing God.
Which is to say, the real estate has become unreal by the way it's trying to play God.
By the way in which it's trying to be in charge.
By the way in which it's trying to be in charge.
And failing utterly.
And failing utterly.
One way of putting our project today is to say we are here to restore the reality to real estate.
One way of putting what we are doing here today is to give reality back to real estate. Amen.
Amen.
Thank you so much. So, thank you so much, Dan. We have more testimonies. The next, I'd like to welcome, needs no introduction for everyone here, esteemed journalist and friend of the Occupy movement, Chris Hedges.
Well, I don't often get to talk as if I graduated from seminary, which of course I did. And I just want to echo Michael that certainly one of the guiding lights of what it means to lead the moral and, more importantly, the life of faith is Father Berrigan. He has been, since I was a small child, being dragged off to anti-war demonstrations by my father, who was a minister, one of those revered figures of conscience. And so it is a tremendous honor to be with him today. I want to read just a small passage from Luke, because I think it is especially appropriate to where we're standing. On the sort of cusp or edge of this great morass of financial speculation and worship of money. This is from Luke chapter 8. Now a large herd of swine was feeding there on the hillside, and they begged him to leave them enter these. So he gave them leave. Then the demons came out of the man and entered the swine, and the herd rushed down the steep bank into the lake and were drowned. When the herdsmen saw what had happened, they fled and told it in the city and in the country. Then people went out to see what had happened, and they came to Jesus and found the man from whom the demons had gone sitting at the feet of Jesus, clothed in his right mind, and they were afraid. And those who had seen it told them how he who had been possessed with demons was healed. Those who worship money, those who stand before the idols of greed, are possessed with demons. And we've come today to call those demons out. I went to school with some of the managers of the largest investment firms of this country. I have been into the floors where they do their trading. And these people, obsessed with personal enrichment and empowerment, who have decided to build tiny monuments to themselves as the product of their lives, are consumed by demons, the demons of greed. They can speak about one thing, money, the money they have made, the money they are making, and the money they will make. Nothing else is important. Not those they love, not the community, not the ecosystem that they are destroying for quarterly profit. When you are possessed by demons, you lose the capacity for the sacred. Everything becomes a commodity. Human life becomes a commodity. The natural world becomes a commodity that you exploit until exhaustion or collapse. And in theological terms, people who orient their lives and have the power to orient our society in that direction are servants of death. These are forces of death. And what we have come to do today is stand up and fight for the forces of life. If we do not radically reverse the direction that those who are possessed by demons are pushing our country towards, the very ecosystem which sustains human life will be destroyed. That is what we are up against. That is what we are fighting. And Trinity Church is the perfect example of a church, or let's say a corporation, masquerading as a church, possessed by the same demons of money. One of the reasons the Episcopal diocese will not speak out for justice is because they depend I think, for about a third of their income on money raised by Episcopal Church. What kind of a church is it that can have as one of its tenant Goldman Sachs, which runs the largest commodities index in the world, and I have spent 20 years overseas in the developing world. I have seen what happens when you hoard futures of rice and beans and wheat, which has increased in price by 100% over the last year. Children starve. I saw it in the Sudan. I've seen it in the Congo. I've seen it in New Delhi, in the slums of New Delhi. Those who trade human life for money are possessed by demons, and we come here today, like Jesus, to call those demons out. And those who cannot free themselves from the grip of demons, like that herd of swine, plunge over the cliff in a great orgy of self-destruction and self-annihilation. Thank you.